as a Maui flight car. It's awesome. It's so cool. But thank you very much for having me, and it's really fun to talk with everyone. And you know, it's very inspiring to see everyone here too. Just a little bit of background of kind of where I came from is that a lot of things that happened in my life with aviation have been through pure dumb luck. And it's just, it's been a fun journey and ride. So I remember right when I got out of college, I flew for the airlines for about 5 years. And then I actually logged into our HR like paycheck system and saw how they classified how they were paying us as pilots was unskilled unionized labor. It wasn't like co-pilot or captain pay or anything like that. It was unskilled unionized labor, and that's kind of how it felt. It was really fun. Got a lot of real world flying experience that way, and I ended up making a career shift into doing some aviation, flying corporate aviation. And what was really fun in that, the best part of that role, or any aviation role, is you get a lot of time off, and that is the most powerful thing you can do. So I started giving a lot of flying lessons and during my time off as a corporate pilot, and realized that there are a lot of people out there that were really struggling in the flight training world to accomplish their goal. They would show up for lessons, and you know, they would get weathered out. They'd have a 2-hour block on a Saturday, and it was a real struggle. And I found that the training wasn't ever really matching up with what, you know, their goal was. And people were really starting to like lower their standards to get out of the training environment just so they can get their license and go. And that's how I ultimately came around Cirrus. Started doing a lot of traveling, and a lot of what Lawrence does is, you know, invite people out and do some pretty intensive training so that you feel good with your goal and you actually find an instructor that cares and gets matched up with what your vision is, your personal vision, and help sees you all the way through to the end. And all of a sudden I found that became so much more gratifying and really teach people how to travel and use aviation rather than just get a license. And that's how I became familiar with the Cirrus brand. One day I got a call from the folks in Duluth, where our Cirrus headquarters were, and said, hey, you know, we'd love for you to become a Cirrus instructor. Not work for Cirrus, but just kind of have a designation and just keep going. I still live in Chicago, and it was a lot of fun. My schedule became full, trying to take people on trips and show them how to get in and out of busy airspace around weather. And then I was doing that for a few years. And then all of a sudden, Cirrus called again and said, hey, would you mind selling airplanes? And I said, you know, I don't know, like, that's not going to make my mother proud to be a salesman or anything. But it was kind of a great pivot. I realized I've never sold anything in my life before. But, you know, when doing things with aviation, I kind of have the heart. I feel like I have the heart of the teacher. And you just really have to sit down and dive deep, ask deep questions from people, and figure out how they want to live differently and teach them how to do that. And that's kind of the way that it's really started to turn into approaching sales and working at Cirrus and diving deep and helping people find, you know, rather than teach them private pilots or to get an instrument rating, now it's teaching them how to own an airplane and actually incorporate and fold that into their life. So I'm a small team member on a big, great network of people that help accomplish that. So it's been a lot of fun, and Cirrus has been a really cool place to hang out for a little while.
We have quite a few young folks here as well that are looking at different career opportunities and choices. And maybe you could kind of share a little bit of, you know, what's a day in the life of a factory aircraft salesperson? You know, what's the fun part of the job and what's not the most fun part of the job?
So there's a few things. I'll take it zoom out just even a little bit as a career in general for anybody that's looking to have a career in aviation. I'm a huge fan of taking the path less traveled. You know, there's always this, the kind of narrow thing is if you're young and like how I approached aviation is like, I want to be an airline pilot. And I started down that path and then ended up pivoting and found that like there's this aviation is not just airplanes and pilots. It's a whole industry. And there's so many different career paths in that. But If you take from a sales standpoint, the big thing that really has been fun is that it really challenges you to think critically and help solve problems for people. So if somebody says, I was kind of listening in the background while you guys were going through your questions, and I was responding to an email, and a guy had sent to me saying, "Hey, I'm thinking about, I have this real need for business to hit every single big city east of the Rocky Mountains." Okay, well, that's a tall order. So you have to sit down and figure out, hey, how do we get you as a pilot to aeronautically grow into that, to be able to fly in Chicago and icing and thunderstorms and travel long distance? It's a big aeronautical challenge. It's maybe a year journey for somebody to get spooled up in order to do that. And ongoing education. We have to figure out what the right plane is for them. So there's a lot of problem solving in order to do that. And the kind of the byproduct of all that, the thing that I find really satisfying, is the relationships that you build with people. So, the relationships you get with people are super deep. And, there's very few people that can really help walk somebody through there and get to where they want to go in the aviation world. Or it takes a big team. You're just a big part of a small person on a big team that help elevate the person up to that level. And that's really, I find that the most gratifying part. And sometimes airplanes are great. They're absolutely awesome. And I wish I could tell you that even a factory new airplane is kind of like a Honda Accord, where all you have to do is change the oil every 100,000 miles and maybe get a new tire or two. These airplanes are handmade. It's not like a robot putting them together and all that. If you're a car manufacturer, you're building, half a million cars a year. And when you're an aircraft manufacturer like Cirrus, you're building 300 airplanes a year. So these are all hand put together. And sometimes those airplanes don't, they break down at inconvenient times, and, and the people might be, they get emotional. And the reason why they're emotional is not because, they're upset or like really ticked off at you, but you realize that, hey, they've changed their life so much and they depend on aviation, that when their airplane breaks and you have to help them, the emotion is that they can't live the way that they want to live. And that's where that kind of boils up. And sometimes, sometimes those answers of timelines of when your airplane's going to be fixed is not, the most fun or pretty news to deliver, but, it's easier to be upfront and work through it. And, there hasn't been an airplane we've been able to, get back going and flying. So that's a nice feeling when you get to the end of a problem like that with a customer. They usually are super grateful, and it feels good just working through and getting it going again.
So one of the things that we had AOPA on last week, and they were talking about what they think is maybe, for lack of a better word, a bit of a renaissance in general aviation that is happening, especially with the COVID virus and sure. People not wanting to airline travel and so forth. Are you seeing a surge or even an uptick in either general interest in buying aircraft, general interest in learning to fly, and just taking control of, people who need to be using an airplane for business? Is that going on, or what do you see out there right now?
So there was let's say at least here in Chicago and Illinois, this, the COVID situation, it really started to escalate in early March, and, we're still kind of in the situation and, people are starting to kind of get back at it a little bit. But, the thing that I've been telling people, I get that question a lot. And there's, let's say we take this 2 month time frame and we divide it into three chunks. The first kind of bulk of this, when COVID was starting to escalate, people, I call it like a cat falling off of a ladder, and it just kind of froze as it like landed, and no one really knew what was going on. People were trying to make decisions. A lot of owners didn't know how this was going to affect their business or how they were going to live. Could they get, I've got a dear client that lives here in Chicago, but has a home in the Bahamas. So they didn't know if they were going to see their home in the Bahamas for, you know, 2 years. Like, is the stuff was starting to really escalate. So everyone was just kind of like frozen. But then, like, as things started to, people started to make decisions in their business and in their needs and all that. So what started to happen is that, you know, if you were a car dealer and people stopped buying cars and stopped driving and staying home, the car dealers were just kind of really frozen and, you know, facing a dark period there for that second part. But I had a couple clients that one builds cardboard boxes for Amazon and one, you know, is part of a big bakery. So they're part of the food chain. So their business started to surge. So it was interesting. You start to see the shift in kind of where things were moving into the economy. Now I would call us, we're right in this last third of this little 2 month escalation. People are starting to trickle back into things, but what the theme, if I were to put one on the on this back portion, is that the agility, if people need this agility in order to move around, or they can start to see, you know, what's going on. So I fly out of the Chicago Executive Airport, and I have an office, and right next to me is somebody that it works in the pre-owned jet world, and he had a real business need to get to Wichita, Kansas. And before COVID hit, there were literally 20 flights a day from Chicago O'Hare to Wichita, Kansas on the airlines. And he would buy a ticket and fly down and then come back the same day or same night or whatnot. But in order to get to Wichita now, there are literally zero flights left from Chicago O'Hare to Wichita, Kansas. And they had to fly from Chicago to Houston, layover, you know, there's not a layover immediately. There's another bank of flights that departs 4 hours later, and then they can hop on a flight up to Wichita. So they had to go from what was typically a 3 hour journey to now a 10 hour journey. And the agility by people that, especially in small towns where there might be one or two airline flights a day, those are gone. And so there's like the agility to move around is there. And people are starting to feel that need. And you know, the tools to them are gone. So a lot of people are starting to say, hey, I'm really grateful that I have an airplane. I'm really grateful that I have just this tool now. It's gone from this fun thing to have to an actual life tool. And so because not only just the agility, the emotions around, hey, I want to get on an airliner and it's gross with people and germs. And the whole experience as we know it on the airlines is going to change completely. You start to see that in a lot of news articles and airlines making decisions that way. So I think everyone here who's trying to learn how to fly, it's not only going to just be a fun personal task to do, but you're going to be forever grateful that you'll have a license that you can use, you know, just to get around if you so choose. It's going to be awesome.
So James Warden's got a question here for Al. What are your thoughts on Cirrus moving away from the average pilot from ever being able to buy a new Cirrus with prices of new SR22s reaching $1 million?
So it's interesting because Cirrus has a handful of different things. So there's a SR20s, they start at $450,000. So a new Cirrus does not have to cost $1 million. And there's a Cirrus out there that really, you know, on the spectrum from our very first G1s all the way to a brand new special edition, which, you know, are $1.1 million. There's a lot of different ways. And Cirrus tries to do a good job of like incorporating and rather than just say, hey, I only want to talk with you if you buy a brand new airplane. We want to make sure that you actually, people that are around the brand and are in the Cirrus family, this is where you see it Oshkosh a lot, that you feel good and included in it. And which is really a lot of fun. You start to see things like Cirrus Embark Training, Cirrus Approach. There's a lot of different tools out there that Cirrus is starting to try to, you know, make available. Even if you don't fly a Cirrus, there's a lot of things that you can try to be around and participate in. So yes, brand new Cirruses are expensive and, you know, it takes a certain type of, you know, financial wherewithal in order to do that. But a brand new Cirrus does not have to cost $1 million, but there's also other little things on the fringe that you can take advantage of like Cirrus Embark training, Cirrus Approach, all the training tools. And in the pre-owned world, I think you could get a SR22, one of the G1 models, or an SR20 for under $100,000 now. So, you know, as you start to expand, it's pretty neat.
I've often heard that Cirrus's biggest competition is its own used aircraft.
Right.
On that?
That is. A used Cirrus is by far the biggest competitor to a new Cirrus. And when you start to look at it, I work with customers. Obviously, I work with factory new aircraft, and there's a huge value. If we're trying to compete dollar for dollar on an airplane, yeah, a used airplane is going to be, a pre-owned Cirrus is going to be cheaper dollar for dollar. But from a value standpoint, it's going to be a much better value. You know, when we're talking, you know, a three-year-old Cirrus or a new Cirrus, the price gap between the two aren't, you know, way off in left field. And sometimes I tell people, you know, the people that are buying these airplanes, like, hey, look, you came to see me in a brand new Tesla. You know, you've got all this new stuff. You're talking about, you know, you're putting everything, you know, you're redoing your house. And you're getting new appliance, like new. Like, we're just, you know, why are we dropping the ball on the 98-yard line? You know, now you get a relationship with me, the factory, you know. So when you're broken down in Montana in the middle of the night, guess what? You can call me and we'll help you solve that, the problem. So there's a value gap there that is really good. And, but some people, you know, they either can't afford it or they just don't see the value and they buy a pre-owned. And we're just grateful that they're within the family and they're being safe by flying a Cirrus.
Have you flown the Cirrus Vision jet?
I have had a few flights, which is really cool. I will say though, my favorite flight in the Vision jet was in the back as a passenger. I did a flight from Chicago to Washington, D.C. And granted, we had a great tailwind, but it took an hour and 40 minutes to go from Chicago to Washington, D.C. And this was in a G2 Vision jet. And I remember it was at nighttime. So it was a very surreal moment. The windows in the Vision jet, if any of you have ever sat in one or have an opportunity to sit down in it, because in the back and just look out, like you can see out the front windows, like and be involved in the flight and see the runway. You're not sitting down. You're actually sitting above and higher than the front passenger. So you've got a really good clear view, but then the side windows are awesome. They are so huge. And you look around, you start to feel like, hey, the outside environment is inside with you. And I kind of liken it to the feeling if anyone has been over to somebody's house where they have a really cool home theater system, and you're going to watch this like awesome video or movie with them, and you just know that it's going to be awesome, like really cool, a great experience. That's kind of what it's like stepping in the Vision jet. And let alone just to fly it, it's super easy. It's a lot of fun. You know, it's almost stalls at the same speed as an SR. It's awesome. It's and that's really what very intentional. So for people to move from an SR into a Vision jet, it's, you know, it's there's so many similarities, even down to takeoff and landing speeds. It's really cool.
If anybody wants to unmute themselves and has a question, Brent or anybody or Charles, we've got some Cirrus owners in the group here. You're welcome to do that. What for the younger kids in the audience, you flew for the airlines. Talk to us just briefly about the lifestyle difference between the two jobs, because you're one of the few that has experience in both realms.
Sure. Like, so I often say to people that they ask me, how many hours do you have? And I'm like, you know what? I don't really care how many hours anyone really has. I care about the stories and the content and the meaning behind them. I felt like I tell people that my airline experience, I'm very grateful for, just because it taught me a lot about real world flying, and just how to approach different scenarios and develop. There's all these different distractions, and you know, I've really pivoted and think that like external pressures on, you know, whether you're an airline and you've got to complete this flight for revenue purposes and you don't want to hold, you know, handful of people, you know, 100 people on board with Twitter accounts and Facebook accounts that could turn into a PR nightmare in a heartbeat. Like, there's all this pressure on that, but, and you fly differently. Like, I wouldn't say it's very controlled, but just the lifestyle is very different. You could literally just show up to a flight in 2 minutes, not, you know, and just push back and off you go. You don't really brief the weather. People do that for you. You don't really do many pre-flights. You do walk arounds, but it's just to check the tires and the brakes and all that. But this detailed, thorough pre-flight you do on your personal airplane, you don't really have that. And so I remember when I shifted from airline flying back into general aviation or personal aviation flying, I was a basket case. Like I forgot how to file a flight plan, forgot how to shoot an instrument approach, forgot how to go to a non-towered airport. Like, I mean, there was so much that had to actually learn how to redo. But what really was able to take with me was how to work around weather, how to work with air traffic control, you know, get comfortable, these little hacks that you do if you're traveling and you're in New York's airspace, like, you know, how do you ask for something that you know that's that's impossible? How do you get that? So there's little things like that that we're able to take with and be able to go. So in the personal aviation world, I found that the smaller the airplane, the more fun it's been. And that's because of the people you get to fly with and the stories that you get to create. You know, and you had zero relationship with any but the passengers at the airline. You really had very little relationship with any crew members that you flew with. You were there with them for 2 or 3 days. You went home, you wouldn't see them again. But these people, you know, you're walking right alongside with people and they're training in a very important goal in their life. And that to me is probably the most rewarding thing in aviation. And it's really fun to find people like that and that want to come in and have a need. And this, like, all of you here are just super excited, you know, to be around this, and you're taking a Sunday evening to come here. Like, that says a lot about you and your excitement to, you know, be here and absorb as much as you can. So, you know, there needs to be people out there to help you. So good on everyone for taking the time, because it's super, you know, it's worth it, I promise.
Terrific. Yeah. I love the positivity. That's infectious it really exudes in everything that you do. All right. So, please unmute yourself. I'd like to hear the stories about how you pick you get the pick of the colors, and how's that purple one doing?
Purple one's awesome. So there's going to actually be a video out next week or early the following week. And it was super cool because we had, we got to, one of the fun things at Cirrus is that they allow us to pick our demonstrator colors, unless a customer's already picked them and maybe bought that particular airplane already and they had an opportunity to. Cirrus has been really fun to be able to allow us to pick up our different color, pick out a color that we like and a tail number. So we have a personal story where we can actually tell, you know, hey, this is how I pick my tail number, or this is how I pick this color. And I'm kind of a bright color guy. So the very first airplane that I had was literally the same color as Lawrence's shirt here. It was this bright green and silver, and it was really fun. And I remember flying into Oshkosh the first time. It was 2017 with this airplane. And I'd been flying around Wisconsin and Illinois. This is my territory that I get to work at. So, like, you know, many people have seen this plane. It was all over the, you know, Facebook and Instagram. People had retweeted or reposted the thing. When I remember flying in, doing the Fisk arrival, and I came in and landed literally on touchdown. I was very lucky to land on the green dot. Like, in my pocket, I could start feeling my phone going zzz, 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 zzz. And there were literally 60 text messages from people, you know, saying, hey, is that you in the green plane? Is that the green plane? Is that you? Is that you? And it was so much fun because the plane started to have a personality. And these big, bright colors that you, these big, bright colors that you see on these Cirruses, they're fun. You know, where you typically see like a neon green Lamborghini, at least in downtown Chicago, I feel like, oh my gosh, this guy's, you know, pulling up to a steakhouse and he's showing off and, you know, wants to be seen and obnoxious and all that. But on an airplane, these cool colors, they're fun. People love it. And my latest one is a purple airplane. And about a week from now, you'll see this this video that we filmed on the Cirrus YouTube channel, We flew from Knoxville, Tennessee to Atlanta Hartsfield Airport, you know, having a great experience flying into a big class Bravo airport, one of the busiest in the world, at least back in March it was. So it's super fun. And, you know, people turn it into a thing. Like somebody, I had a customer send me purple shoes and somebody sent purple sunglasses and they started to get purple stuff. And it was like, you know, that's how much fun this stuff should be, versus, you know, and put personality into it. And, you know, there's no rules around that. So it's fun.
If you could let people know how to find you on social media. And I know you also do an occasional YouTube and so forth.
Yeah. Well, it's awesome. If any of you are on Instagram, you can go to al.waterloo and you can follow me there. And you'll see plenty of pictures of the green and the purple airplanes and all that. And my colleague, Amy Voss at Cirrus, she and I, every Wednesday and Friday, do a little live session. Lawrence, I know you've been participating on those and really appreciate that. And, you know, starting to put out a handful of different little YouTube videos that are really cool and just share different stories, and, you know, kind of blend a story into real life flying and how to approach that and work towards it. So, if you follow Instagram, it's a great place to start. And we're always, each week we're posting a schedule of what we're doing. And when a new YouTube video comes out, would love to participate or have you guys join.
Awesome. All right. Any questions for Al here? And James wants your link. I've got it right here, James.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen the Blue Angels before? I heard they were flying for the front workers.
Yeah. So they actually, I've seen it a couple times. There was... just recently here in Chicago, literally right over my house, they did the flyover salute, and it was really fun I was very moved by that, surprisingly more than I thought. I've seen the Blue Angels plenty of times, but to actually have them over your house, not at a big airport or an air show, it was really like, that hit me, and it was cool. It was just like that, and it was over, but it felt really nice. But one of my favorite Blue Angel stories was that I was actually in 2014 doing a delivery in Duluth, Minnesota with a client. And this guy, he was actually one of the, he was pretty high up in the Navy and was worked in the Pentagon and bought a new Cirrus. And he was one of the test pilots for the F-35 new fighter jet. And he had flown plenty of times with F-18s and all that. So during his delivery in Duluth, the Duluth Air Show was going on. And the Blue Angel crew literally took over the Cirrus headquarters. You know, if you've ever seen the Blue Angels, like there's not just seven airplanes, but there's 200 ground support people, staff. They bring in stuff well in advance and all that. So literally outside this guy's delivery bay was the Blue Angels like firing up and, you know, super precise. I'm like, the doors are open and I'm like pinching myself. I'm like, my God, this is awesome. Like how cool is it to be having your airplane be delivered? Like right while the Blue Angels are doing their startup procedure and bringing people in and out and all that. And I look back into the delivery bay and this guy, the owner, was just continuing with his new pre-flight. It's like, the thing didn't even, like the Blue Angels didn't even phase them that they were there. And I look at him like, hey, come over here, stop. Like, this is a cool moment. And he's like, no, I know all those guys, they owe me beer money. And it was just great. And it's like, and that's how it was. He, like, as soon as they landed, he delivered, he goes out, starts shaking their hand. We got a little personal tour of the F-18s and everything. It was cool. So it's pretty impressive. If you ever get an opportunity to see the behind the scenes stuff, the Blue Angels do. It's not just seven airplanes, but it is literally 200 people that travel with that team.
Awesome. Any other questions? Well, Al, thank you so much for spending time with us and sharing your stories, and really enjoy everything you're doing, and a great ambassador to aviation. So we really appreciate it. You're welcome back anytime, and safe flying out there, and hopefully you'll have an awesome rest of the year selling more airplanes.
Yeah, well, appreciate it. Good luck, everyone. And if anything we could do to help, you know, this is, you're at a great spot with Lawrence, and we'll see you out there. Good luck.
Thank you. All right, we'll be IFR ground school in just a minute. We're going to take a 1 minute break here.
Hey, Lawrence, I forgot to ask one thing, if you don't mind. I want to get a selfie with everyone here, and real quick. So, and I'll post it to my Instagram. All right, here we go. Nice. All right. See everyone. Cool.
All right. That was a lot of fun. Okay, so we're going to start the instrument here. As far as tomorrow's private pilot, I guess what we can do is we'll go ahead and meet online, and we can just review things that we won't go to the next section, but we'll go ahead and just review other things. So let me just stop a few things.